e-melt is there for a very specific purpose. It's for e-melt to protect the very nature of what's special about Cambridge, and it's to protect South Cambridge from the sort of urban sprawl that could threaten it and which could turn it into the likes of Oxford, which is not something we want. So as soon as you start laying great swathes of concrete through the green belt, what you then do is isolate areas of land which are connected to the city, which you then have very, very little reason not to fill with housing. And proposals I've seen so far do exactly that. You suddenly end up with little islands of greenbelt, which we will not be able to protect from further development in places where, if things are left as they are, development would never be considered. So you need, this is about a lot more than just laying concrete for bus lanes. You've got to think what the consequence of that is. And in the consultation with the options for the A428 work, it was a false choice. There was three proposals there, none of which were very good, and so people voted for the one that was the least awful, yeah. And the danger there is that that is interpreted as support for that, rather than a vote against the other two, which were even more awful.
Right, can we now go to vote on this resolution 2, please? All those in favour?
Any against? Thank you.
So, Rod, can I invite you again to talk on the consultation process? Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. I'll shout. I'm not a teacher, but there we go. So, the proposals that impact the 428 and Western and Orbital are important. And they're important because they impact the lives of residents and communities along the possible routes. So if one were starting with a blank sheet of paper in relation to the consultations at the end of last year and the spring of this year, what were the criteria that one would apply, or the features that one would apply? And what I was looking for in those consultations were a logical reasoning as to why the proposals were coming forward, i.e. need-based evidence as to why these proposals were being put to us. So that was the first thing. The second thing would be a clear explanation of those proposals and what they were. The third thing would be that those proposals would be supported with facts relating to these specific items. And then finally, I would expect an extensive, comprehensive communication programme between the City Deal and all stakeholders, residents, opinion groups, and so forth. In my view, the consultations that were held last autumn and in the spring failed on all those four features, and I just wanted to expand a little in terms of why I believe they failed. So firstly, the idea of setting out the logical reasoning, the need-based evidence as to why the proposals were being put to us. Well, we've just heard this evening, a key component of that evidence, for example, the city centre access study hadn't even been started when one of the consultations had finished. So residents didn't have all the pieces of the jigsaw puzzle of which they could then be informed and of which then they could take a view. The second feature, in a place like Cambridge and the surrounding area, failure for a consultation to have that fundamental foundation will result in it falling at the first hurdle. Because we're not stupid, and we expect that such consultations are based on fact and evidence. And in many ways, I heard from a lot of residents last year and in the spring of this year that their frustration with the consultation was it wasn't grounded in that evidence-based support. Secondly, it failed to set out in clear, simple ways what was being proposed. A basic requirement of any consultation. It had different routes in different schemes, depending on what the presentation you went to, and even at one stage, the online version of the consultation was different from the hard copy version of the presentation. Not a good illustration of how presentations should be undertaken. It failed in terms of making sure that the proposals were supported by facts. We've all heard the story about the journey time calculations, which in my view were undertaken on different bases depending on what route was being proposed. Again, a fundamental flaw. And then finally, it failed to have a clear, comprehensive communication programme. I felt that the City Deal was struggling to keep up with the overwhelming response that they'd had to the consultation, and it often left elected representatives plus residents with the task of informing people and in telling people what the consultation was about. And again, not an ideal way to run a very critical consultation. But for me, there were two other points that it's worth making, particularly which are relevant for the part of the consultation which was in the city, in Newnham. One positive and one negative. The positive was there was an overwhelming response from residents in Newnham. Overwhelming. Everybody basically took up the challenge to respond to the consultation. The negative, and it's a fundamental negative, the basis of the consultation set resident against resident because of the way the schemes were presented. And that is not good for a community. And so therefore, I hope that any of the consultations going forward, specifically to these two schemes, reflect on these observations. Thank you.
Thank you. Comments from the floor? Yes.
I wrote to the County Council about the consultation and surveys because I was horrified, as somebody who's involved a lot in market research and used to conduct consultations for a county council, a very large one, to find that the online survey was different from the printed paper survey, that the online survey controlled the answers in such a way that no intelligent person could answer the question properly. And of course, the paper survey, which had no instructions as to how it would be answered, allowed people to put in a range of answers. I have to say I was frankly astonished that the response of the County Council, who didn't respond to my first letter of complaint last November, but did when I complained a second time in March, was that in fact they're not obliged to make sure that the consultation process from that point of view is accurate. As long as they say the process is fair, they admit that there were differences between the two surveys on both occasions, and the most disturbing thing for me was that the staff who were responsible for processing the results of the survey were given guidance on how to interpret the public's answer to the questions in order to compile the results of the survey. Now, I consulted some colleagues in the Market Research Society who pointed out that the surveys would have failed the GCSE you can take in this subject for the quality of the design. I've also taken some pro bono legal advice which would say very, very clearly, if any member of the City Deal team uses the results of this consultation survey as the basis for any decision they might take, we would be entitled to take them to judicial review and they would lose.
Thank you.
I also think, as somebody who does
10 seconds.
consultations and prefers, they call them high level feasibility, they're actually conducting at the moment very low level feasibility studies. I do Her Majesty's Treasury Green Book feasibility studies, and these are just a farrago of how to go about it.
Thank you. Anybody else have a comment in the audience?
Do I need a microphone? Just a quick comment to endorse your very articulate summing up. I've attended 3, if not 4, assembly meetings, 2 board meetings, 4 hours at a time. It was very distressing to see how the results of that Cambridge survey were presented. And a very member of the public asked, you know, could you just acknowledge that there were process flaws? You know, it's a very difficult thing to do a survey, and we realise that, but could you just acknowledge process flaws? There was coercion, people were choosing the least worst, whatever the expression is. And the officers in the final chair's report of the Assembly refused to acknowledge this. So the actual Citygate Executive Board got this very misleading report that there was no process flaws, that everything was wonderful, and 67% of people supported the Madeley Road scheme. And for a start, it wasn't even an option, it was just a concept. So the amount of misinformation, it's been really awful. And this is a marvellous forum to people to acknowledge it. So thank you.
Who are conspicuous by their absence in this room? Who are disproportionately more likely to use the public transport solutions that are going to be put in place by the City Deal?
The young.
Louder.
The young.
Thank you. Yes, we don't have that many young people in this audience, and I have asked repeatedly, given that we've got Cambridge Regional College and Anglia Ruskin University on the City Deal assemblies, to do proper consultations with their students. I'm still waiting. Challenge to all of you councillors around this table at the secondary schools that you have in your wards. If they can't do it, please can you do it on their behalf, because otherwise their voice is missing. Thank you.
Very good idea.
It's not just the accuracy of factual information in the last sentence. What they also ought to be providing is some form of summary of the social and environmental impacts of the options. Without that information, you cannot make an intelligent choice between the different options if you are not told what the social and environmental impacts will be. This is meant to be sustainable development. Sustainable development is not just economic development, it has to be balanced by the social and environmental impact. They should put that into the consultation document so we have a broader understanding of the issues upon which to be able to make a better informed choice.
Commenting on this now, please.
Can I just make a comment on the last point of the accuracy of factual information, including maps, or especially maps? So from a Coton perspective, if you cast your mind back to the busway consultation, you may remember, and the same applies to the Western Orbital consultation, you may remember Coton being presented on those maps as a little blob, and various lines relating to those options clearly passing outside of the boundaries of Coton, and to the uninitiated eye having no significant impact on our village, and that's clearly grossly misleading. I'm actually going to do a small presentation before the next, or the resolution after next, in which I will show a map which indicates the likely paths of off-road busway solutions, and they clearly pass right through the village, and you know, if we walked out of our village hall, you would be able to see potentially the bus right whizzing past your face. So to have a map where to somebody who didn't live here, it really did look as though it was nowhere near the village or was not going to have an impact, is clearly misleading and casts the whole consultation process into doubt.
And to add to that, of course, the areas of the village that were most affected were not there at all. Anybody else? Okay. So we're going to have a quick vote first on whether we should add the information should include a summary of the social and environmental impacts of the proposals. So that would be in the final sentence. I haven't read that out, have I? Shall I read that out?
Yeah, it's fine.
Okay. Okay. So can we vote on that, please? All in favour?
Any against?
responses.